Well, thank you very much for the kind introduction, and thanks also to those in the centre who have looked after me so kindly and efficiently since my arrival yesterday. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I am really honoured and touched to be invited to give this first memorial lecture for the life of Vojin Dimitrijević. And I have tried to choose a theme which I have entitled Rules, Choices, and International Law that will reflect issues that were very present in Vojin's life. So I begin by saying that in 1988, I attended a small private meeting in London at which Sakharov was to speak. I came away with my head full of thoughts, and predominant among them was this: how conditioned most of us are by our circumstances. What we believe is necessarily dependent on what we know or what we are allowed to know. So how, in a closed society where one view was allowed to predominate, could Sakharov in the Soviet Union have possibly achieved his unerring view of what was ethical and right? And I was convinced that the ability to do this is exactly what makes a person exceptional. Vojin Dimitrijević, too, has always had this deeply rooted inner core of democratic values. I met him first, though our paths have crossed many times since, when I joined the Human Rights Committee under the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights in 1985. This committee, unlike many in the UN, prided itself on its professionalism and on good personal relations among the many nationalities represented there. The two members from the Soviet Union and from East Germany sincerely committed to the ideals of Marxism were fine colleagues, but I immediately realized that Vojin was altogether different. He was seemingly untouched by the political system that held at that time in his country and relied only on his own personal values and those of international law. I was frankly mystified as to how he could have been nominated at that moment of history and gratified that he had been. All of this was done without explanation or fuss. There was no campaigning or expounding or important position taking. That was not Vojin's style. He simply got on with the task in hand with great competence and with an unfailing instinct for what was necessary for human rights to be made real. His technique in examination of state reports was not so much to ask questions as to make observations. these observations, made in his calm and gravelly voice, were invariably penetrating, allowing of no facile response. They were, in a very real sense, home truths spoken to the representatives of states. In the best traditions of the committee, he treated all states in precisely the same way. And I know this is an audience of friends, so I will also tell you that I used to be acutely embarrassed that after making these critical observation of a state, he then would retreat behind his newspaper and read it. Vojin was an important figure in the development of the case law of the committee. He brought a formidable combination to every case, an open mind and a mastery of public international law. His knowledge of human rights was soundly grounded within a confident competence in international law generally. He was often the person turned to when the committee was deadlocked on a particular case. This was not because he would fashion a compromise. Unsatisfactory compromises were not his thing at all. It was rather that he would see a different way of addressing the question. A way that was at once legally sound, but could provide a bridge for us all to cross together. I was baffled as to how this lawyer, so resolutely his own man, could be a member of the Human Rights Committee at a time of communism in his own country. For many of liberal instinct, the passing of the old order in the late 1980s allowed a well-enjoyed, a well-earned enjoyment of better times in their countries. For Dimitrijević, as for so many in the former Yugoslavia, this transition was, on the contrary, painful and traumatic. He faced many new problems, many new dangers. Everything was faced with low-key courage. His ethical core never deserted him. I want to say to you this morning that international law is not about the neutral application of rules. It does, to be sure, contain rules. That is to say, law that does not allow of argument or debate about the circumstances. So the fact that the Security Council has 15 members is a rule. It can't be 13 members on Monday because it's cloudy and 15 on Wednesday because it's sunny. It's a rule that it's 15. Of course, the Charter can be revised in very, very rare circumstances, but most of its rubrics, not all, most are properly to be described as rules. But international law generally, mostly, comprises norms. That is to say, articulations of law that seem definitive, but on closer examination have a competing opposite norm. Let me give two examples. Everyone would recognize that the precept that the law, that the use of force by one state against another state is unlawful. But that's not a rule. It's a norm. And that's because there also exists the contrary idea that nothing in the Charter removes the entitlement of a state to use force in self-defense. I give another example. We might recognize the rule that territory entitles jurisdiction over people and events. But in fact, that too is a norm and not a rule, because we can think of various opposing propositions that there is such a thing as universal jurisdiction over events committed wherever, that the assertion of jurisdiction may occasionally be based on nationality. By far, the greater part of international law is made up of these norms, competing norms, so the decision maker has to choose between these norms. The particular circumstances may help in making that choice, but there are real concerns, which is why some classical lawyers like to say that law is the impartial application of rules. There are real concerns that such choices could be subjective and indeed arbitrary. There exist certain well-developed criteria to avoid those hazards in choice. These relate to values, thus rejecting the idea that law is value-free. It is rather a normative system for the achievement of certain values. In making choices between competing norms, I myself have always found it helpful to have in mind outcomes that benefit the many rather than the few, that support the dignity of individuals and groups and respect diversity and promote non-discrimination. And I'll say some words on the topics of non-discrimination and humanitarian intervention, which shows that choice is in reality a necessity when faced with such norms. Every international lawyer is imbued with the idea of non-discrimination. There's a long history in the subject. The principle of non-discrimination was present in the jurisprudence of the Permanent Court of International Justice. That court showed a profound insight, still relevant today and used today, into what was necessary to make the protection of national minorities a reality. In the Polish Upper Silesia case back in 1926, the court insisted that what the minority was entitled to in fact as well as in law, and that therefore it was not for the state to identify who belonged to which minority. In the minorities schools case of 1928, the permanent court determined that special needs and equality in fact are indeed closely interlocked, for there would be no true equality between a majority and a minority if the latter were deprived of its own institutions and was consequently compelled to renounce that which constitutes the very essence of its being as a minority. Of equal importance were the findings on what does not constitute discrimination. It was not discriminatory to limit minority schools to those whose minority language was in fact their mother tongue, for therein was the key to benefits. We all have a general sense of what is discriminatory. International law has sought to tie the idea to discrimination on the grounds of race, color, sex, language, and political opinion. This formula is to be found in many treaties, including the European Convention on Human Rights and the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. In recent years, the formula has sought to keep up with the realities and with the times by adding the prohibition on grounds of ethnic, national, social origin, or sexual orientation. The general comment number 18 of the Committee on Human Rights under the Covenant, on which Vojin and I worked together, tells us that, I'm now quoting briefly, non-discrimination, together with equality before the law and equal protection of the law, constitute a basic and general principle relating to the practice of human rights. One question which the committee had to grapple with was whether that meant that no claim could be brought of discrimination as regards matters not to be found within the provisions of the covenant. For example, the covenant does not purport to deal with social security and disability benefits. It would seem, upon a mere reading of the text, that no claim by a citizen in respect of discriminatory treatment by a state in such matters could therefore come before the committee, which specifically prohibits discrimination in respect of rights guaranteed by the covenant. However, the committee ruled that Article 26 of the covenant was more generally formulated, prohibiting any discrimination under the law. The committee decided that if a country had no law on a particular matter, discrimination in respect of it could not fall within its remit. But if a government did allow an entitlement as a matter of its national law, the covenant prohibited discrimination in respect of that entitlement, even if it was not a legal entitlement found in the covenant itself. And so it came about that in a series of cases on which Vojin and I sat together, the Netherlands was held to have been in violation of the non-discriminatory principle in Article 26 in respect of social security and disability benefits. This was not easy for the Netherlands, which with justification regarded itself as a law-complying nation, and which was somewhat astonished at the finding of discrimination in respect of something, social security, on the face of it outside the covenant. I know, and it's been brought to my attention, particularly since I've been now a long-time resident in the Netherlands, that there were serious and long discussions in the Dutch government about these findings, not least because there were very considerable financial implications flowing from them. In considering its course of action, the Netherlands could not only have challenged the correctness of the finding, but it could also have insisted that the committee was not a court of law and could, at the end of the day, be ignored. But the commitment of the Netherlands, both to international institutions and to the concept of non-discrimination, was such that these findings were, in the event, accepted and acted upon. And I have always hugely admired this. Of course, non-discrimination does not necessarily require that everyone be treated identically. There may be reasons, good reasons, for differentiations being made. If a state decided to provide free transport for its pensioners, it will not have violated any non-discrimination provision by making the younger pay for their trams and trains. I benefit in the Netherlands from the 65, 65 plus tickets at the cinema. And I feel there's no discrimination against the youthful moviegoers. General comment 18 deals with this in paragraph 8. I remember working on this also with Voyen, which provides that, and I quote, the enjoyment of rights and freedoms on an equal footing, however, does not mean identical treatment in every case. It continued, not every differentiation of treatment will constitute discrimination if the criteria for such differentiations are reasonable and objective, and if the aim is to achieve a purpose which is legitimate under the covenant. I need hardly say that excluding persons from profession or from serving in particular jobs on their basis of religion, race, political belief can never be anything other than discrimination. There's a huge amount of international case law on this topic, and a very special interest, I think, has been the interface between the international and national law on the question of positive discrimination, sometimes referred to as affirmative action. The United States, in particular, has over the years struggled with these complex issues in a series of cases where those then referred to as black students were given certain preference in university admissions, entry to the police course, and so forth. The United States courts held that, provided a past inequity was being redressed, provided there was a current societal need for the current imbalances to be alleviated, provided the measures were temporary, and provided the measures did not amount to quotas as such, they were not unconstitutional. There are, I think, recent indications in the US case law that today, with so much progress having been made across those areas, these ideas no longer hold. The handling of this question, and I come back to my running theme, requires a constant sense of values made tangible by ethics. I'll say a word on humanitarian intervention. The question of so-called humanitarian intervention is one of the controversial contemporary areas of international law and one where ethical considerations are to the forefront. For some, the right of a state to use force in international relations is strictly constrained by the combined effect of Article 2.4, the prohibition, and Article 51, the self-defense clause of the Charter. Force against another state, therefore, may not be used unless it is in self-defense or authorized by the Security Council as necessary for the maintenance or restoration of international peace. For other states, some situations may be so appalling to see and do nothing, as they represent the ultimate immoral act. And some states who think the an intervention is called for, and for some states who think the potential for abuse is so worrying that there should be no publicly acknowledged entitlement to intervene, even in extremis. That becomes the predominant criterion. Actions by individuals or groups in Kosovo, Sierra Leone, now Iraq, are examples of the range of dilemmas that spring to mind. In recent years, some, but not sufficient persons, have begun to appreciate that the legal question of humanitarian intervention cannot be dealt with in isolation. It cannot be dealt with just centered on a perception of sovereignty which refuses all outside interference. I remember when I was now at the court, very clearly, Secretary General Kofi Annan speaking in our Great Hall. That's the hall where the cases are heard. In May 1999, shortly after the NATO bombing of Kosovo, in the wake of the horrors, including ethnic cleansing being perpetrated there, there was a great debate raging as to whether this military action, classified by those engaged in it as humanitarian intervention, could be lawful. Kofi Annan reiterated that force was only to be used in individual or collective self-defense. But then he said, and I paraphrase him, "It is not enough, however, that states simply berate unuseful, unlawful uses of force. They have a responsibility, which they are failing to exercise, to ensure that extreme situations of suffering where a state or state feels the need to call for humanitarian intervention do not occur. It is not enough to allow such situations to arise and then simply to protest at actions perhaps unlawful to alleviate them." And this line of reasoning, which I personally appreciate very much, was courageously pursued and elaborated by Ban Ki-moon, who went through all the terrible things of the last of the 20th century. He listed them all, you know them all, and at the end he said, "Could we not find the will and the capacity in the new century to do better?" Sadly, the answer to this last question appears to be mostly in the negative. But there was an increasing effort led by Ban Ki-moon to breathe life into the concept of responsibility to protect. Francis Deng, the distinguished Sudanese academic and occasional representative of the Secretary General, worked on refining the concept of sovereignty as sovereignty as responsibility to one's own people. If states would fulfill that fundamental obligation, there would be far fewer reasons to be concerned about unwelcome intervention from abroad. It was at a conference in Canada that the phrase responsibility to protect was coined, and it was detailed in some sense with, one has to say, a lot of support from the French. It was thought that while the scope of it should be kept narrow, the response ought to be deep. Now, one can debate the legal title or heading given to an international agreement on the need today for action in northern Iraq. to me, this wholly exceptional tacit agreement that we see, because I believe that is what now we see, is a working exception to the political disagreements that characterize the Security Council. There is no great adverse efforts made by the Soviet Union or China. Indeed, even Assad, maybe for mixed motives, has said that even action in Syria will not give rise to any protests by him. The responsibility to prevent, one of the three elements said by the United Nations Commission to be integral to the concept of responsibility to protect, was addressed by the court when it handed down its judgment in the 2007 judgment in the so-called genocide case, that is Bosnia and Herzegovina against Serbia and Montenegro. And all of these very difficult and ethical and normative questions are being worked out against a changing political landscape. It used to be said that the major debate was about the circumstances in which intervention might be legal under the Charter, but the dangers in allowing any such possibility. Then the dreadful events of the conflicts in the Balkans, which you know so well, and awful events elsewhere, led, as I've mentioned, to this concept of the responsibility to protect. And in the last couple of years, the background to the legal arguments have shifted yet again. Even when governments have believed it to be both ethical and politically important to intervene militarily, it seems that their own body politic and their public have lost the appetite. My Prime Minister David Cameron thought that the horrific acts being perpetrated by President Assad of Syria warranted the international enforcement of a no-fly zone. Anxious to avoid the errors of the coalition action in Iraq without authority, anxious to avoid that, he put the matter to Parliament, and he failed by a large margin to get the votes he needed. He accepted immediately. I remember being astonished that I was watching the debate, and I remember expecting him to say, we'll have to give careful consideration to this. But he said immediately that he knew he could not proceed with a no-fly zone in Syria. And President Obama has articulated again and again that there is today, after Iraq and Afghanistan, no appetite in the United States Congress or public for the US to become militarily involved overseas. And yet, the clock begins to move again. The fearful suffering being inflicted by ISIS on persons of different faiths or even different strains of the same faith seems to be causing a shift yet again in public opinion back towards some form of military intervention. As you know, the United States is engaged in aerial action against ISIS in Iraq and also in Syria. The United Kingdom has come in on the aerial action in Iraq after getting parliamentary authority, and it will not expand this action into Syria, increasingly thought to be necessary as that is where the military strength of ISIS emanates from. He won't go in for that without going back to Parliament, a matter on which he feels bruised in the past. I want now, before moving to my concluding thoughts, to say something about rules, justice, and ethics. As I explained in my introductory remarks, while norms allow of choices, rules definitionally are law, which are clear and set. And much of our national law is articulated in the form of rules allowing of no debate. But what of the ethical problems that arise for a judge, for a professor, when the law concerned is deeply, deeply unethical? For the lawyer, the question of unjust laws presents very particular issues which have special importance in the realm of human rights. Neither the ordinary citizen, nor indeed the judge, can simply pick and choose between laws he or she likes or does not like. The guiding principle that the law is the law feels less clear than the soldier's guiding principle, orders are orders. For that is generally recognized to mean that the soldier's duty of obedience ceases in the face of an order to commit a crime. But how are ordinary people to be protected against pernicious laws, and what role can the lawyer or judge play in such protection? In 1949, Radbruch, a German professor, had something to say to his students. He wrote a letter to them, Fünf Minuten Rechtsphilosophy, addressing the lawyer's dilemma of the relationship between legal security and validity on the one hand and the sense of justice on the other. He explained to the students, I'm now quoting him, he explained, the conflict between justice and legal certainty may well be resolved this way. The positive law, secured by legislation and power, takes precedence even when its content is unjust and it fails to benefit the people, unless the conflict between statute and justice reaches such an intolerable degree that the statute is flawed law and must yield to justice. Now, this so-called intolerability formula is often referred to in shorthand as the Radbruch formula and is referred to as such in the judgments of German courts which have had to face this issue. And as you know, many German judges left their homeland rather than apply Nazi laws. Of course, this reasoning has not been without its opponents. For example, British legal philosopher H.A. Hart, who insisted on the separation of law from morals, Without this separation, said Hart, there would be a confusion between law as it is and law as it should be. This is, of course, really a debate about legal positivism and other approaches to international law, on which there is much to read. It also feeds into the larger question of whether law is indeed value-free, or is rather a tool of social engineering, the very purpose of which is to secure particular values. Some great jurists, like Lord Denning, the famous English judge, somehow adroitly skated over the dilemma. He never admitted to choosing the law as it should be over the law as it is. He had a strong sense of justice, and somehow, through inventive interpretations, the law as it is always was the just legal solution. He was greatly admired and generally a beloved figure for his simple way of speech and kindness in court. But he also had his opponents who thought that he delivered justice rather than legal certainty. In international law, we find something of the same debate. There, the operative concepts are a bit different. Lex lata, the law as it is, and lex ferenda, law in the making but not yet crystallized. The law as it should be is assimilated into this notion of law that is not yet fully formulated. Some international lawyers, again those inclined towards positivism, insist upon a rigorous distinction. My own approach has been to avoid the dichotomy as much as possible, not by the rather sleight-of-hand method of Lord Denning. Rather, in my own view, as I've said, law is really not to be seen as rules, but as opposing rules which may be chosen between. I gave you the example of no use of force, self-defense. And that can only be done by articulating the values which can be promoted by the one choice as compared with the other. But in any event, this is a matter of general philosophy and not confined to the agonizing choices between law as it is and justice. Now, sometimes this question, and I'm near the end of my remarks, sometimes this question of unjust laws presents itself in a very stark fashion, even to the academic lawyer. In November 1940, the German occupying authorities in the Netherlands issued an edict requiring the dismissal of all Jewish academics from their posts. They were to teach no more. On the 26th of November in the University of Leiden, at the very hour the Jewish professor Meyers should have given his customary lecture, Professor Klaveringer presented himself to the students instead and gave a momentous address. He protested strongly against the dismissal of Jewish academics. He told the students how fundamentally incompatible was the dismissal order with the Dutch tradition of equality and non-discrimination, a tradition, he said, that reflected itself not just in laws but in the very life of the nation. He then spoke of the greatness of his dismissed colleague Meyers. His lecture was the embodiment of the university motto, Praesidium Libertatis, bastion of freedom. The next day, Leiden University was closed, and Cleveringer was taken by the occupying authorities to Scheveningen prison. And so it went on. Professor Koningsberger, professor of plant physiology, had also spoken out against the dismissal of Jewish colleagues at Utrecht, as did Professor Telders, who many international lawyers here know of, and others at Leiden. Professor Telders was imprisoned shortly after the famous November the 26th lecture. Telders was sent to Bergen-Belsen and died in that place of horror shortly before the British liberation. Cleveringer was freed from the Vught camp in 1944, and he existed as a non-person in the Netherlands, waiting for a post-war future, living, in fact, to become rector of Leiden upon the liberation of that university and the Netherlands from German occupation. So I come now to my few concluding remarks. As we've seen, law is not mere rules. There are more often than we may discern choices to be made, and these choices will often have ethical ramifications. Sometimes in life we may be fortunate and have only modest ethical decisions that we are called upon to make. These will come up in our private life and in our public life. Some of us will not have had this easy passage and will have lived through hard times with tough choices and perhaps personal danger associated with those choices. Throughout the years, Vojin never complained about the hand that fate had dealt him. I think the fact he remained so grounded lay in the reality that his students were central to his life. As a university teacher myself at that time, I best knew Vojin at the Human Rights Committee, and I was always struck by how often Vojin would in private speak about his students and what he'd said to them on this topic or that. I felt that he knew that to explain to students was something he had to do not only about the substance of the law, but the values it stood for. And that is the greatest gift a teacher could bestow. So I'm honored to remember him here today in the company of his family, the Institute, and his students. Thank you very much for this invitation.
Thank you, Judge, for your time.